Hi, good morning. My name is Wayne Modest, and I am head of the Research Center for Material Culture, which is you're sitting in it right now. You're sitting in our newly established research center. And we're pleased to have you here today to engage with us in a conversation. A conversation that we're doing jointly, and you'll see all the partners, the research center, Lucas, but also the Locken Hall, as we've been part of an ongoing process with the exhibition that many of you might have seen already, which was not started through the Locken Hall, but invited us to participate. And it has been a joint process of thinking through what does it mean to think, to imagine the globe and imagine globally. This particular symposium is organized here at the center with Kitty and I and others thinking about, and the presenters this morning will try to tackle that subject. How do we imagine the global? And it is very important that we here are thinking about it. We are what would be called an ethnographic museum, some call it that. Some call it Folkkunde, some call it Volkskunde, some call it anthropology museum. But more than that, we are an institution with a collection from across the globe trying to understand through material things a set of problematics, a set of ways in which people structure their lives and understand themselves in relationship to others. And that is what we do. The intention of the Research Center for Material Culture is to stimulate research innovations in collaboration with different partners to think through a set of questions. We've established a set of themes, one being, and this is part of that project, one being thinking about the globally interconnected world is one. And if you walk into many exhibitions in all kinds of institutions, sometimes we've been accused of not thinking about the global interconnections. We've been accused of thinking of space and place and culture as mapped into kind of fixity. And so, which, to be honest with you, that accusation is sometimes very in the past, because we've been doing a lot more projects that have questioned that in the present. But notwithstanding, we thought it important to pull that theme out as an ongoing set of conversation about what does it mean to think globally. And this is one part of that conversation. Other themes that engage our interest right now is how do we use these collections? And I should say to you that the Research Center for Material Culture forms part of the National Museum of World Cultures, which everybody tells me is a difficult title. But anyway, it is the Tropo Museum, Africa Museum, and Museum Folkkunde, which is here, which together we hold a collection of 375,000 objects and almost 1 million photographs drawn from all over the world. We think about our photographic collections as coming at the beginning of the first announcement of photographic practices, and drawn from, so through that we can think about, if we think about it as we have photographs from the 1850s from the Caribbean, from 1860s from China, from 1840s from places like Suriname, then we can think that it offers us the opportunity to rethink what the history of photography is in different locations, and how photography emerged, changed, and moved as we in different spaces in the world. And our other themes, for example, is on the digital. And not just the digital as tool, which is very often how museums use it, you know, let us catalog our collection, but actually to ask the question about what does it mean to be digital subjects? What does it mean? How does the digital change us as subjects? And what does it mean when we use this word digital culture? What does that mean? So later on, early next year, we're going to have a small symposium to ask that question as well. And just one joke I should tell you, if you look in our collection, I've never understood it. Museums traditionally collect games. We have a lot of games. My museum, games from all over. We have no digital games. The question then is why, what happened in that transition moment between the games, gaming, and the digital? And why did we stop? at the digital. So the question, that's the kind of thing that we are interested in. And Meta did something which was beautiful just now, which she pointed at one of our presenters today, Femke, who is also interested in that kind of thinking new media and thinking how new media helped to structure our relationship. But also Shani, who is here this morning. So I'd like to welcome you. This is going to be a conversation. We've structured it hopefully for conversations and not the big lecture and then the question answer after. So some of the presenters will also have their own conversations before we open it up to the audience.
So these are all the partners, and this is all also the entanglement and speaking in terms of interconnectednesses, De Lakenhal, Leiden University, 440 years here, Museum Volkenkunde, Lucas, which is my research institute, Leiden Global. And if you all connect them together, but I didn't know where to find one of these knots in on the computer, everything boiled down into the Mailfabriek where the exhibition is now. But it all started with an imagination. I'm not sure if you still remember Gyro Gearloose's little helper, but even as a four-year-old, I was totally in love with this little guy. And why? Because if Willy Wortel, that's the Dutch name, Gyro Gearloose, when he had an idea, the little lamp went on. And I was so fascinated by that. So it all started with an imagination to have a big contemporary art exhibition in Leiden, showing artists from all continents. This imagination was shared by the group of curators we formed to realize the exhibition, and I just mentioned them all. Representatives from Museum De Lakenhal, from this museum, and Manon, who we flew in from outside, Manon sitting over there, who is our project leader. Except for that, we were supported by our intern, Hidde van Groningen, who now is former student of art history, and of course, as fellow thinker and co-organizer of the symposium, Wayne Modest and Anke Bangma. In the preparatory stage of the project, we had numerous meetings, obviously organizational and curatorial, but also a number of expert meetings, for which we invited scholars and critics to share their ideas with us and to give us critical feedback. The imaginations took shape and grew into the current exhibition. We offered the frame, but the artist provided the visualized and materialized imaginations and truly created a world to discover. But the genesis of this idea lies back a few years earlier. Meta Knol, at that time a curator at the Centraal Museum in Utrecht, had organized the exhibition Beyond the Dutch. In Indonesia, the Netherlands, and the visual arts from 1900 until now. And that was in the Centraal Museum in Utrecht. I came in later to co-edit the accompanying book. What interesting about this project was that it was the first show on art from Indonesia on this scale to date, and it centered around three liminal points in time. 1900, the colonial period, 1950, fight for freedom and independence from the side of Indonesia, and 2000, post-colonial era. On her preparatory trip to Indonesia, Meta asked if and how contemporary artists in Indonesia, we still recalled it yesterday, today still relate to the Dutch or the period of the Dutch colonization. I almost said occupation, but which is close to the truth. But she got as a response, "Come on, Meta, we are beyond the Dutch." And that is a telling statement. Holland is no longer the center towards all is geared or from which everything departs. Indonesia is its own center, defining its own periphery, and Holland may not even be part of that. It is not easy to leave one's Eurocentric point of view, but it is paramount to realize what your locatedness, if not biasedness, means, both personally and academically, to understand today's world. This is something that I've been working on and have been propagating in my teaching and research since the mid-1990s. My call to show your colors is geared towards a comprehension of the perspective from which you look at the world, from your own background and education, and to acknowledge and appreciate other standpoints, seeing Europe not as the center, but as a province of the world. Or perhaps, to use Dipesh Chakrabarty's words, what it means to provincialize Europe. With regard to political history, he argues to recognize a deep depth to European thought, but at the same time, to know, and I quote, how universalistic thought was always and already modified by particular histories, whether or not we could excavate such pasts, unquote. Much of this history and its legacies, such as the phenomenon of political modernity, that is, the rule by modern institutions, the state, bureaucracy, capitalist enterprise, scientific rationality, and notions such as civil society, citizenship, human rights, etc., may have had at some point in time as frame of reference European thought and history, but, so Chakrabarty continues, this heritage is now global. After all, the 19th century European colonizers both preached this enlightenment humanism at the colonized and at the same time denied it in practice. And he adds that matter-of-factly. But this heritage sources were multiple and not singular. Instead of one human universalism stemming from Western European humanism, there exist diverse ways of being in the world, and these are interconnected with multiple historical and present-day ties. This connects very well with anthropologist Anna Lowenhaupt Zink's analysis of global interconnectednesses, so I mean the plural, in her book Frictions from 2005. Her point of departure is that global connections are everywhere. But she then poses the very simple, as hard to answer question, so how does one study the global? In her book, she makes an ethnography of global connections, zooming in on zones of what she calls cultural friction, which are more often than not born out of distress. Global connections give grip to universal aspiration, Zink says, and it is precisely this attention to the universal, not the Eurocentric humanist truth claim of the universal, but very much similar to Chakrabarty, the basic given that we are all human, and that we are stuck with universals created in cultural dialogue. And this is one aspect the project Global Imaginations touched upon. How do ideas of the universal rub against global interconnections? Jensen's globe, made of parallels and meridians forming a rationalist system of coordinates, and enclosing excerpts in Chinese from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, marks the entrance of the Global Imaginations exhibition. Around the equator, Jensen has attached chairs from various cultures and times facing outward. The title is telling, we are with our back to fullness, facing emptiness, obviously not aware of what lies behind us and what we could perhaps easily access. If we would just face one another, and as important, to follow Levinas's call to show respect for the face of the other, because it is the irreducible otherness of the other which may open up a dialogue. The Declaration of Human Rights may be embraced by the globe, as you can see, but apparently not by its inhabitants. Meshagaba's flag, Citoyens du Monde, citizens of the world, that we have taken as our banner for the exhibition and many other sites, also testifies of this equivocality. A citizen is a member of a political community who enjoys the rights and assumes the duties of membership. But this is far from reality. And we are far from daily reality. And we are also more than our nation-state identity. Moreover, Gaba's flag, another nation-state symbol, which consists of all nation-state flags of the world stitched together into one whole, is as much a construction as Jensen's globe. In our discussions in preparation of the symposium, we have many times asked ourselves, what work can the imagination do as a future project? what possible futures can be conceived by constructive imagination, by challenging frames of knowledge such as predominant taxonomies, categorizations, cartographies, and notions such as globalization. These are all concepts, and there are many ways they have been given shape in the past, and they're always open to new possibilities. But concepts do not necessarily come before concretization. Nothing is logically predetermined or naturally given. Matter and mind co-evolve in the process of a creative act. And this is where, more than anyone else, or anywhere else, the artist comes in. Arjan Apadurai suggests that the collective imagination leads or contributes to the emergence of a non-anthropocentric yet social force. And I quote, "The image, the imagined, the imaginary, these are all terms that direct us to something critical and new in global cultural processes, the imagination as social practice. No longer mere fantasy, no longer simple escape, no longer elite pastime, and no longer mere contemplation, the imagination has become an organized field of social practices, a form of work in the sense of both labor and culturally organized practice, and a form of negotiation between sites of agency, individuals, and globally defined fields of possibility." Unquote. The imagination as a form of work and a form of negotiation implies an activity, a process of becoming between agents and possibilities. On the intersection of three ways of accessing the world, academia, museums and their collections, and contemporary art, new imaginations can take shape. We need them more than ever. The present-day situation marked by ongoing rapid changes in new media technology, the unpredictability and vulnerability of the global finance system, and the significant rise in voluntary and involuntary migration demands that we seek out other, more novel approaches to understanding global relations. This symposium foregrounds arts and artifacts more broadly, potential to help us comprehend the complex, multifarious, and even chaotic entanglement of the world we live in. It is our contention that contemporary art can help us find alternative, diverse mappings of the world, opening up unexpected, unusual, and even disparate imaginings of these global entanglements. So one question we put to the symposium, what role do artists play to make visible the flows and frictions of global interconnections? How do artists intervene in existing worldviews, and how do these interventions help us to understand the complex fabric of today's world? If we, with Chantal Mouffe, acknowledge the political in its antagonistic dimension, envisaging the problems facing our societies in a political way, and art as a force to subvert the dominant, We should acknowledge with Chantal Mouffe the political in its antagonistic dimension, envisaging the problems facing our societies in a political way, and art as a force to subvert the dominant hegemony.